Hi everyone, we're back here with Dr. Jenna talking about vaccinations. So Dr. Jenna, welcome back. There's a lot of interest from people in getting vaccinated. Some are excited, some are concerned. What do you think are the key benefits of getting vaccinated?
Well, first, thanks for having me back. This is, as a medical professional, an exciting time to be here to talk about this. I think it's a very optimistic time for us. So in terms of some of the key benefits that we're seeing with vaccines, there's two major benefits. The first is for your own health. So dealing with severe COVID-19, which we define as severe enough to be hospitalized, all of the vaccines that have been approved in the United States, for example, have shown pretty much 100% efficacy against severe COVID-19 illness. Meaning if you get the shot and you were in one of these large clinical trials, none of the patients who got the shot required hospitalization. So that's huge. That's a big health benefit. There's a little bit of variable efficacy in terms of preventing mild or moderate illness, but it still goes a long way. So Pfizer and Moderna shots are both associated with about 90% or slightly higher efficacy against preventing mild or moderate illness. And speaking as a medical professional, even when someone has moderate illness from this, it can put you out of work for 10 to 14 days, and people are having some prolonged symptoms even after they start to recover. So major benefits for preventing illness. The other major benefit that I think we all feel as a globalized society is the risk of infecting others. And we do think that that risk is greatly lessened when you take a vaccine, which has implications for quarantine and for travel after receiving a vaccine.
So what vaccines are even available in the U.S.?
Yep, so the three current FDA-approved vaccines under emergency use are the Moderna two-shot mRNA vaccine, the Pfizer two-shot mRNA vaccine, and the Johnson & Johnson vector virus vaccine.
We're hearing a lot about variants from UK, from Brazil, and other locations around the world. Is there any information about how effective the vaccines are with the variants?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that's one of the biggest topics we're looking at right now in terms of predicting the future if we can. So what's interesting is that both of the mRNA large phase 3 trials, so Moderna and Pfizer, they were both done largely in locations where there wasn't much variant spread yet. And so when we look at the efficacy of those vaccines, we have to do it with a little bit of a grain of salt. By contrast, AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson's vaccines both had large clinical trial sites in areas where there was variant spread, both B.1.1.7, the UK variant, and then also the South African variant and the Brazil variant. So we do have some real-world data, meaning patients who got the shot, we can see how efficacious the vaccine was against those variants. So for the South African variant, there was reduced efficacy for mild to moderate illness from COVID-19 for both AstraZeneca and Johnson & Johnson. Fortunately, it looks like those results didn't translate to severe illness, and there was still a very large protective effect of both vaccines against severe illness from the South African variant. We are still very engaged in research looking at how the vaccines affect your own protection against the variants. What we have now, with the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines is more in vitro evidence. So looking at, drawing someone's serum and seeing how well it neutralizes the virus in a petri dish, for example. So that is not as applicable to real world data, but it's something that we're continuing to accumulate.
What are the risks associated with the vaccines? And then second, should employees be concerned about Operation Warp Speed and the approval process and how fast it went?
Yeah, I think that's, it would be silly not to think about those implications when we had vaccine invention to approval within a year. It's the fastest approval we've had for any vaccine, which is amazing. I think before this, the record was 4 years. So at least in the United States, the way that the process worked and the way that it was sped up, it was sped up by Operation Warp Speed, which just for any viewers was, it was a large monetary investment made by our Department of Health and Human Services, given essentially to six candidate companies. And what it did was it encouraged large pharmaceutical companies to take the financial risk that they might otherwise not have. And so in that sense, they were able to pool resources very quickly and put a lot of time, effort, and money into these vaccine candidates. And so that sped up the research effort. The other way that Warp Speed sped up vaccines you know, production is the manufacturing capacity. So once we had our phase one and two trial data showing that these vaccine candidates had a very good chance of being successful, they already started scaling manufacturing. And so that's where some of those curves were cut. Looking at this as a medical professional, I don't think that they cut any curves in terms of the FDA approval. All three of the candidates we had were subject to very large phase three clinical trials, and they had to show rigorous safety and efficacy data in order to get the FDA approval. So I don't think that any steps in terms of patient safety were really skipped. I think the steps that were expedited were the initial investment and the manufacturing scaling.
Mm, okay. What are your thoughts about the efficacy or the safety of the vaccine?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think that's a good sort of separate question from how they were approved and then getting to the nuts and bolts of what you can expect when you get it and, you know, if you have a history of allergies. Some of the most common risks associated with the vaccine and more side effects than risks would be things like local injection site pain, pretty common with most vaccines. And then with our COVID-19 vaccines, we are seeing things such as mild nausea, muscle aches, fever, and fatigue. Those are probably the most common side effects we're seeing. So when you go to get your vaccine, we're not currently recommending pre-medicating or, you know, taking an ibuprofen before you get the shot. But if you start to develop one of these common side effects, it's perfectly safe to take a fever-reducing medicine such as Tylenol or ibuprofen. If you're someone who has a history of multiple medication allergies, first of all, that's probably worth just discussing with your doctor, just to make sure that you're getting advice that's sort of personalized to you. But we're not currently recommending taking an antihistamine such as Benadryl before the shot. We don't want to mask any early allergy symptoms. So those are the main side effects that you can see with vaccines. In terms of diving into what to do if you have a history of allergies, any history of allergies is not a contraindication to getting one of these vaccines. If you have a known history of an allergy to a component of the vaccine, you should talk to your doctor for advice about which type of vaccine to get. And patients who have a history of allergies to vaccines or general allergies will be monitored for an extra amount of time after the shot.
A lot of our employees have teens and children. What's your take on teenagers and children taking the vaccine at this time?
Yeah, I think, you know, the first thing is that we have to follow what's approved by our regulatory agencies. So the Pfizer vaccine, for example, is approved for ages 16 and up. They included adolescents ages 16 to 18 in their study. And so if you have a teenager who's 16 or above, we've got robust data from the Pfizer trials showing that they can safely get the shot. We do know that the kids are an important population to get vaccinated. School spread is going to become a bigger challenge as more kids are going back to school. And so they're an important component of our population that needs to be vaccinated for prevention efforts. So there are multiple vaccine candidates that are currently enrolling kids in studies. For example, Pfizer just finished a study of 12 to 15 year olds, and the efficacy data looks fantastic. We haven't seen any major side effects in that age group. The Moderna trial just recently started enrolling very young children from 6 months up to 11 years. That's called the COVAKID trial. And so we'll start to see data trickle in from that trial in the coming months. Probably towards fall, we'll be able to see some study results. But for now, just following the regulatory guidance for which vaccines are approved for kids is important. One thing that's interesting about kids getting vaccines is that they tend to have a little bit more of a reaction just because they have pretty robust immune systems. And so you might see a higher rate of fever or other sort of mild side effects from vaccines in kids. Conversely, the risk of severe illness in kids is less. And so I think for parents, it's going to come down to having a good understanding of why exactly they're vaccinating their children. And from a medical professional standpoint, it's to prevent the spread of infection, which is going to be a higher risk in children. And because even though certain conditions are rare, such as the inflammatory syndrome in kids with COVID-19, it's still something that you don't want to have to face as a parent or as a child getting the vaccine. So,
yeah, makes sense. You know, just getting a vaccine appointment in some parts of the country has been a real challenge. So I know it probably varies from county to county or city to city, mm-hmm. but what's your advice? What do you have any general advice you might offer?
Yeah, of course. I think it's been a challenge for everyone, just with, you know, keeping up with the scaling to the demand. I think the first step is checking your state public health guidelines for who's eligible. More states are making, you know, everyone eligible above 16. I think almost half of the U.S. states currently are at that point. So checking the eligibility. And then after that, most public health websites that are individualized to state, they have certain links that you can follow to look for availability in your state. It might be like a color-coded map that can show you where vaccines are available, be it at a hospital system or a pharmacy. There is a website called Vaccine Finder, which is basically a pooling of federal pharmacies, Walgreens, CVS, other federal pharmacies that can show nationwide where you can get a vaccine. So I would recommend checking that out. And then also word of mouth. So each state county has individual resources such as clinics where they might get a batch of vaccines in. And so if you hear about that, it's good to keep an open mind and sort of pursue those resources. But I agree, Scott, it has been a challenge, and hopefully that challenge will become easier with increased supply.
Okay. What can employees expect when they actually show up for their vaccine appointment?
Mm-hmm. Yes, so there's going to be sort of a quick identity verification process. Generally, the person providing your vaccine is going to be some sort of medical professional, usually a nurse or a nursing tech, a medical tech. And they'll just verify your medical history with you briefly and verify that you don't have any allergies to the vaccine components and discuss with you which vaccine product you'll be getting. At some point in that process, too, it needs to be verified that you can return for a second appointment if you're getting the Pfizer or Moderna shot, in the U.S. at least. So those are all things that will be done up front. Once you get your shot, you'll get a card that has the dose and the type of vaccine you were given. This is specific to the U.S. It's not laminated, and you'll want to bring it back to the second appointment if you have a second appointment. Once you get your shot, there's a 15-minute period of recommended observation. So if you were to do a mass vaccine clinic, for example, with cars, you're going to be pulling off to somewhere where you can be observed for 15 minutes to make sure that you don't have an allergic reaction. And if you're someone who's prone to allergies, you might be asked to wait 30 minutes instead. But those are sort of the general expectations for what will happen at your appointment. Some people can feel sort of non-specific mild symptoms from the vaccine, like a little bit of nausea, a little bit of lightheadedness. So I would personally recommend bringing a little bit of water and maybe something to snack on in case you have those symptoms. If you start to develop hives, itching, any sensation of breathing difficulty, you'll want to immediately let the vaccine clinic health professionals know so that they can assess you.
Okay. Is it immediate, meaning once you get your shot, are you protected?
Oh, no. So that's a great question. So we're getting more and more evidence to sort of support that the effects start fairly soon after. So for example, with the Pfizer vaccine, there's about a variable 60 to 85% protection 2 weeks after the first shot. What we're seeing and saying is that your immunity is complete 2 weeks after the second dose of either Pfizer or Moderna, or 2 weeks after the single dose Johnson & Johnson vaccine. And it continues to improve with time up to 4 weeks after.
Okay. And as more and more people get vaccinated, what's your opinion? What's going to happen with all the protocols we've had to deal with masks and social distancing? Mm-hmm. You know, what's your take on, is that going to be here to stay? Is that going to go away? What do you think is going to happen with that?
It's tricky from an individual business regulatory standpoint, and that's currently a very controversial topic with this suggestion of vaccine passports. But there is regulatory data from the CDC, for example, that patients who are fully vaccinated, so those who are 2 weeks out from their second dose of Pfizer or Moderna, or 2 weeks out from their single dose Johnson & Johnson, they don't have to quarantine, for example, if they've been exposed to someone with COVID-19. So that's a change. The other change is in terms of travel considerations. We're still not yet recommending travel just for travel's sake. We're still recommending essential travel at this point. But coming from the CDC, you don't have to have a test before and after travel if you're fully vaccinated. So those are some of the big differences. In terms of how we're behaving in public, there is still the recommendation to wear a mask and keep a physical distance of 6 feet or more when you're in public, even if you've had the vaccine. There are some considerations for personal gatherings. So for example, if you're vaccinated and your family member's vaccinated, you don't have to necessarily abide by masking and physical distancing anymore. But I would strongly recommend checking the CDC website because there's a lot of nuance to who can congregate and how many numbers of people, even if you're vaccinated.
Okay. Well, thank you for some really great information. And hopefully this encourages our employees to feel safe and go get vaccinated, because I think that's a big step.
It is.
Moving forward.
Absolutely. So thanks for having me.
If you have any questions, by all means, please talk to your HR business partners, your medical provider, or your EHS managers at your locations for more information.